Hodder and Stoughton Audio presents Thursday Nights at the Bluebell Inn by Kit Fielding. Read by Gina Murray, Melanie McHugh, Ellie Heydon, Abby Hardiman, Jilly Bond, and Lucy Paterson. A darts match on a Monday night in October. The Bluebell versus the Naggers. Katie. It's Monday night, my night, and Jerry's sitting in front of the fire toasting his toes while I'm running around like a blue-ass fly. I'm clearing up, washing up, sorting out Laura's clothes for the morning. I say it wouldn't hurt you to help. Shifting himself into a more comfortable position, Jerry says, I've been out in the bloody wet all day. You know it's darts.
It's always darts for you, Katie.
Oh, yeah? So who cooks the meals, who cleans the house, who looks after... Then I can't be bothered to go on, and he's not listening anyway. My lovely daughter Laura, soon to be 16, belt for a skirt, lolling in the armchair, rolls her eyes towards the ceiling. If you two are going to start, I'm off to my room. She flounces out, looking like me, but talking like him. I say, look what you've done.
He says, look what you've done.
He draws out the you've in a condescending, of course it's your fault, intonation. I want to spit at him, but I light up a fag instead, because that really gets his goat since he gave up smoking.
Not in here, Katie, he snaps at me.
And because he's going bald and is conscious of it, I say, okay, keep your hair on. And he says,
ha, bloody, ha.
It's 5 minutes till I have to leave and I'm looking in the mirror, putting my face on. Jerry's still flopped in his chair, staring at the telly and mumbling, what a load of bollocks. But he doesn't take his eyes off the screen. And you know what? I briefly feel sorry for this deflated man whose hair is peeling back from his temples. Is he as unhappy as I am? But the moment doesn't last because he opens his mouth and dredges up a loud belch. Pig, I say.
At least I don't look like one.
This cuts me because I've been trying to lose a bit of weight. You know, easing down on the chips, only having 2 slices of cheese on toast. I'm not fat, just a bit over the ideal. What's the word? Voluptuous. That's it. Voluptuous. Like Nigella Lawson. Big and beautiful. Well, dark-haired anyway. In my reflection, I suck in my cheeks to give myself the hollow look, check that the flabbiness under my chin isn't turning into another chin. Then I work on my eyes, squint on my eyeliner, squint again for my mascara. I step back to admire my handiwork. I'm not exactly a pale-skinned, slow-eyed beauty, but it's not bad, Katie. Not bad. You used to fancy me, I say to Jerry.
Used to fancy a lot of things.
I shake my arse as I mock leer at him from the mirror. Fancy a bit of action, he says with no interest.
Maybe later.
When, after you've filled your guts with lager? He grins then.
It deadens the pain.
I have to laugh. And there's a second of how it used to be. I pick up my handbag, check I've got my darts, and then I'm ready to go. I say, make sure Laura goes to bed on time. As if he will, and as if she would. But I've got to go through the motions. So I leave Jerry warm and comfortable and fucking selfish to his evening in front of the fire, to his collection of porn DVDs and cans of lager. He'll come along to the Bluebell a bit later, in time for a couple of pints before closing, and a couple of free sandwiches off the team's plate. Jerry calls the Bluebell my second home, because I spend so much time there. But even my crummy council house is in better nick than this pub. The Bluebell might be half comfortable inside, but the outside could definitely do with some help from DIY SOS. Danny the landlord calls it his Victorian wreck, and he's not joking. There's dead weeds in the car park and withered flowers spilling over the hanging baskets that are hanging by a thread. Something to watch out for on a windy night, or when I'm sitting on a plastic chair in the designated smoking area, which is where I should be sitting now, because I'm taking a last few pulls on my fag outside the entrance, under the rusting sign of a faded Bluebell, before I join my teammates. And in the Bluebell, my girls are practicing for the game, taking it in turns to throw their darts at the board. Behind the bar, Danny, the landlord, giving his paying customers his rear view, is playing with his newly fitted toy, his CCTV monitors. I interrupt him. Any chance of getting served here? Danny turns around, lets his wandering eyes wander up and down my body. There's every chance of that, Katie. I say that I'm fed up, not hard up, and he shrugs, says that it's my loss. I tell him that he's probably passed it anyway, and he pats his stomach and says that he's as fit as a butcher's dog. He's got the dog bit right, because he's the spit of an old greyhound. Same colour, same knobbly joints, same way of scratching his hair for a hidden flea. So it's 6 drinks I buy for the Bluebell ladies, for 6 of the best. For Irish, Mary O'Brien, Mother's Ruin and Tonic. She's a shade on the blousy side, pushing 50 and always moaning about her gobshite of a husband. For Maggie, half a cider, because of the old man. Won't see 60 again. For Lena, WK Blueberry. She's 25 years old and the biggest flirt in the pub. Short skirt, low top and big, big eyes. For Scotty Dog, aka Marie Stewart, whiskey and water, and go easy with the water. Lives alone with her cats in a smelly terraced house with a jungle for a garden. Must be 70 if she's a day. For Pegs, same as you, Katie, lives in a park home on a traveller's site. 20 years old and darkly pretty, but keeps herself that little bit apart like gypos do. For me, vodka and coke. Me, Katie Jones, 35, heavy smoker, and thinking my life's over. Well, the fun part of it anyway. So we sip our drinks, get in some more practice on the board and wait for the opposition, the Nag's Head ladies team, the Naggers, to turn up. Irish, already ordering another drink, says to Danny, "So what's with that then?" And nods her curiosity towards Danny's side of the bar, towards the newly set up CCTV screens that are snapping postcard views of the Bluebell. Insurance wanted them for security, in case of thieving, Danny says. "Who'd want to steal anything from this shithole?" says Irish. Then Scotty Dog says, "I bet the pervs put one in our bog." Danny laughs. "Shouldn't think anyone's seen yours in 30 years, Scotty." Scotty Dog says, "Assassinac's never going to see it, Danny boy." Old Bob, standing close, but with his own conversation going on, says, "Would have been better to spend the money on a pot of paint. Place ain't seen a brush since VE day." He's probably right. The ceiling is a dirty yellow from generations of fag smoke, and on the wall by the gents is an enamel poster for Craven A cigarettes. Our opponents, that's too strong a word, friendly rivals is better, arrive to start the game. They're a gentle team, about halfway up the table, and that's ambition enough for them. "Bad luck in the cup this year, K.E.," says their captain as we make the draw. She adds, "Again," as if I didn't know. At least we're putting in some good results in the league. We're a quarter way through the season and lying third behind the Moonies and the Battersby Babes. But you know how sometimes you get the feeling it's your turn, a time for you? Well, that's how it seems to me. I go to sleep at night playing out the games that we've got left, imagining winning. Actually winning the Division 1 Ladies League. Jerry reckons I'm obsessed, and I cut him a blinder and tell him that's all I've got to look forward to. And the horrible truth is that it seems to be true. Anyway, Danny wants some silverware for the shelf behind the bar. And ever since we'd been playing here, he said, "If you lot cut down on the boozing, you'd start winning." Lena, leaning forward to show off her boobs, says, "You're a fine landlord telling us not to drink." But Danny's not really hearing her. He's fighting a losing battle, trying not to look down her top. So that's where we are on this Monday night, recovering from being knocked out of the cup and wanting to keep this good run going for the rest of the league. "Nearest ball then, Katie," says the captain of the Naggers, and promptly launches her arrow into the 25 to start pole position in the team game. I'm first throw on our side and I get us away with a 60, In fact, all of my sides score well, but so do the naggers, and it's only a fluky treble 18 that leaves me wanting double 16 with a dart still in my hand. Irish in my ear whispers, "Give it fuck, Katie." And the double seems to beckon my dart in, and we're out. We've won the team game. I can hear Irish giggling behind me. Well, they didn't keep up with the Joneses. So it's been close, and gasping for a fag, I head outside for the table and chairs of the smoking area. There's a light rain falling, and it's starting to get dark, and I'm thinking, bloody smoking ban sending me out on a night like this. I'm only there a minute when Johnny James comes out through the door rolling up a cancer stick. "Chilly out here, Katie," he says, and lights up. Now, I don't know what to make of Johnny James. I always seem to be bumping into him. We'll have a chat, a few words about nothing much, but he has this habit of looking directly into my eyes with his deep grey ones, and I, well, it's a stupid thing to think. He must be 5 years, perhaps a little bit more, younger than me, and I'm slightly plump, and how could he possibly be remotely interested? Anyway, I've got enough trouble with one man without going off into a fantasy land with another. Johnny says, "How's the game going, Katie?" "One up, Johnny." I'm puffing furiously at my fag, guiltily hoovering up the nicotine when I should be inside encouraging my team. I drop my half-finished habit onto the slab floor and grind it to death with my toes. Better get back. Check how the girls are doing. See you a bit later. He holds me with those eyes. I think he means the next fag break, but it sounds like an invitation to... No, he doesn't. He's just being pleasant. I say, "I expect you will. I'm out here every hour." And that sounds like a confirmation to a question not asked. Inside, Pegs, quiet Pegs, is on the board, and she's struggling through her game. The chalkboard shows her inconsistency with a 45, a 30, a 26. When she comes back to the hockey, Irish shoves a drink into her hand. "Get that down your neck." I say, "Just slow down, think about it," as Pegs nervously quickly drains a half glass of vodka and coke. "That was my drink," I say to Irish, but Pegs has thrown a ton, and Irish laughs. "It went to a good cause, Katie." I go to the bar to order up, and from the pool room side, Johnny James is paying Danny for a pint. When Danny serves mine, he says, "All done, Katie. Your admirer bought you it." "Admirer?" From the other bar, Johnny James raises his glass in a toast. "Don't be daft, Danny." But I can feel myself, of all things, starting to blush. Whenever we play at home, we have support from a quartet of regulars. These are the guys who seem to live in the pub. If I call in for a packet of fags, or if Jerry and I visit on one of our rare nights out together, some of them are always here. Danny calls these waifs and strays the motley crew, and they drink the day and night away. Jerry says the Bluebell would go bust without them. I tell him Carlin would be in dire straits without his contribution to their sales. He doesn't think this is funny.
"If you slimmed down, you could get in the door to Weight Watchers," he says quite nastily.
I reckon that if he smartened up, he could become a slob. And that's how it seems to go on between us, this kidding that's not really kidding. Anyway, our local support, the motley crew, from old Bob to Paddy to Jilted John to Pikey Pete, Peg's cousin, are fun drunks, not nasty, falling down, troublemaking drunks. They booze and joke and laugh at each other. Tonight they're in a singing mood and half cut, they drift over to watch the game. So our local support, starved of entertainment, get behind us. "Come on, the Bluebell girls. Come on, luscious Lena." Lena perks up at the attention. She starts to pose on her throw, bottom pumped out, bosom thrust forward. When one of her darts bounces out of the board and she bends over to pick it up, the whistles and cheers must be heard halfway across town. But this distraction is fatal for Lena and a setback for us. Her game goes to pieces and she's well and truly trounced. If you couldn't see the next three games, you'd know who was playing by the songs the wags of our supporters put together. Scotty Dog gets "Donald, Where's Your Trousers?" lead vocals by Old Bob and Pikey Pete. Maggie gets Maggie May, the choir led by Jilted John, and she moans to them that Maggie may not if they don't give her a bit of ush. But it's Irish they love. And every time she throws her darts, it's when Irish's eyes are smiling. This is started by Paddy because this is the song he sings every night without fail at checking out time. Saves me shouting last orders, says Danny. Irish tells them they won't be smiling if she doesn't win this effing game. But she keeps her cool and collects her double out as the naggers fall at the last. So it's drinks all round again, and my head's becoming a bit fuzzy. The girls, my girls, are on a high. Maggie, on several ciders too many, keeps saying she must go home cause he really shouldn't be on his own. Okay, I'll just have the one, only the one, mind. Even Pegs, our lucky gypsy mascot, is letting her hair down. The trouble is, the more she drinks, the quicker, the thicker her traveller accent becomes. Doherty Dick O'Rackley, she says to Pikey Pete. Don't ask what it means, I haven't got a clue. What with it having the same effect on Scotty Dog, ye can't tell me that, and Irish, I'm after thinking this is a great day in my life. There's only half the team speaking proper like. I'm thinking that I've nearly had enough for one night when Danny lines up around on the bar. For Christ's sake, Danny, I'll be on my arse in a minute. Irish says, never look a gift horse in the mouth. I say, I'm off to put a ciggy in mine. Outside in the dim lighting of the leper colony, Johnny James is smoking his roll-up. Katie, he says, feigning a cough, I've been through 3 fags while I'm waiting for you. I have to laugh, but inside me, I wonder if it's true, the waiting. As Johnny's going in, he says, I'll be at her again at 10. Might see you then. Might do. The way I say it sounds teasing, like I'm flirting. I make a mental note to study up on the vodka. Our fan club has retired to the bar to be closer to the beer, and my girls have commandeered a table to sit at. Been on my feet all day, says Maggie. Twice my Ken went walkabout. Second time he nearly made the bypass. I've seen her holding her husband's hand, leading him back to their house through the streets like a scolded schoolboy. Maggie says they want him to go in a home. I wish I could put gobshite in a home, mutters Irish.
My Aunt Zilla had Alzheimer's, says Pegs. She used to get up in the middle of the night, walk around the site like a ghost.
Lena says to Maggie,
it must be awful for you.
I forget sometimes that there's a side to Lena that's not all boobs and bum. It always surprises me. Scotty Dog reckons the drink is affecting her waterworks, and because it's contagious, Lena, Irish and I join her in the loos. I touch up my lipstick, check my eyeliner, can't think why, while Irish, toilet door wide open, carries on a conversation with us as she sits on the bog. Her skirt's bunched up, and when she's finished, with a contented sigh, she stands and her skirt drops back to her knees. Irish goes straight to the sink and Lena says,
you didn't pull them up.
Pull them up?
Your knickers.
I'm not wearing any.
Irish lifts her skirt and sure enough, she isn't. I say, you'll catch a chill, Irish.
Lena says, for God's sake, don't trip over on the way out.
Scotty Dog says,
you'll frighten the horses, Irish.
Irish reckons she could do with a good stallion.
Better than the little gobshite I've got at home.
She's combing her hair through her fingers and looking at herself in the mirror above the sink. She sets up a pose and asks,
do you think I'm getting a little on the plump side?
Scotty Dog says,
you're an ample woman, Irish.
Ample? What the fuck does ample mean?
Fat,
says Scotty Dog, which I think is on the harsh side because I'd say that Irish was just well covered. She's a bit like me, but with a bit more. You know how a song can take you back years? When we sit ourselves down again, the jukebox has been fed and there's a tune on from 20 years ago. I look around this pub where nothing much has changed in all that time. Those words, I will always love you, and that gentle, insistent tune used to drift out the back door of the Bluebell as I sat 15 years old on the wooden bench in the warmth of a summer evening. Then I was desperately wishing to join in the freedom of age, craving to be older. That one worked out all right, didn't it? Jerry would sneak me out a drink, a vodka drowned in Coke so it didn't look suspicious, and he'd bring out his pint. Every window of the pub would be open, and the jukebox would track my crush on this laughing boy with his thick mop of brown hair. He was handsome then, Jerry was. He didn't have a paunch, and I was as thin as a rake. Those long summer evenings were spent sitting out the back of the Bluebell, sharing cigarettes and talking, always talking about anything, about nothing. Jerry had a car, bit of a wreck, mind, and sometimes not taxed. But in that car, we'd drive miles. Some Sunday mornings, he'd pick me up from home and we'd just drive to anywhere that took our fancy. Then we were happy. So happy. The day I was 16, I walked out of school for good, got a job in the packing factory and told Mum that Jerry and I were looking for a flat. Mum says sadly, "Don't you want more than that, Katie?" But all I want is to hold Jerry every night, wake up beside him in the mornings and live my life with him. Mum says, "You can do all that later. You've got all the time in the world." God, I know now how right she was. And suddenly, I'm in one of those if only I could turn the clock back moods. Maggie says, "Penny for 'em, Katie." I say, "They're worth nothing." And the bitterness in my voice surprises even me. Irish says, "The mood of her. You'd be thinking we'd just lost the bloody game." Maggie says gently, "Come on, Katie, buck up a bit." I try because I know that Jerry will be here in a minute, and if he sees my long face, it'll give him something else to go on about. So what I do is take my last £20 note, the one I'd been saving for midweek shopping, and buy yet another round of drinks. Afterwards, when everything came to a head, I reckon that this is what did it, that drink. I take a huge gulp of my vodka and Coke and then, even more fuzzy-headed, go for a smoke. There's no one else out here, and I sit on the damp bench under a dripping plastic cover and wonder if I'll be sitting here in 5, 10, 20 years' time. I might even die out here, some old crone puffing on a last fag, while the world carries on beside her. I've started to feel really sorry for myself, and all because of that bloody song. Even now I can't get it out of my head. "I will always love you." Pfft, well, I fucking won't, and I fucking didn't. And then, believe it or not, I start to cry. I put my head in my hands and I cry for a life that's being wasted, for a young girl with all her hopes and dreams standing before her. I cry for a me that was. That's what Johnny James must have seen, me crying. Perhaps he even stood over me for a minute before he sat down beside me, put his arm around my shoulders and drew me gently towards him. "Katie, whatever's the matter?" Well, I'm not going to answer that, am I? So what happens? What do you think happens? I kiss him, that's what I do. I put my arms around his neck and I kiss him long and hard. "Jesus, Katie," he says, and then he kisses me back. "You're all woman, Katie." Now he's kissing my neck. He's gentle and warm, and his hands are caressing everywhere, and I mean everywhere. Then he puts his mouth to mine again, and it feels like heaven to be wanted so badly. But I need to take a breath, to draw air. "Johnny," I say, "give me a breather." I'm saying this, and over his shoulder I can see a pinprick of red light, and it seems to be flickering, pulsing, and it's a bloody camera. It's Danny's security camera beaming me into the public bar. I freeze, and I've got this image in my head of me, of us, captured in this black and white scene of deceit. And what if Jerry's at the bar, leaning over and saying, "A pint, please, Danny"? And what if, while Danny's pouring up, Jerry scans the CCTV screens and forever the voyeur thinks, That couple having a snog and more. They're going for it. Hang on, wait a minute. He squints at the picture. That looks like... I say to Johnny, the camera. The fucking camera. He goes, shite, Katie. Do you think anyone... Later, Irish says to me. He stood at the bar as still as a statue. And Danny was saying, that'll be £3.20. He says it twice and Jerry doesn't move, just stares at that screen, Katie. Then Danny turns round to see what's got Jerry's attention and says, Jesus Christ, isn't that... Irish says, and then Jerry walks out like he's a zombie. He leaves his beer on the counter and quiet as a mouse, he walks out. She sighs like she's disappointed. He just walks out. I say, who knows? Who else saw? Just me and Danny. And he's not a one for the talking. We've stayed behind, me and Irish, and the bar's empty, and the jukebox is on automatic, and every fucking song that's playing sounds like a requiem for an act of folly. I'm drunk, I know that, and I'm saying, it was only a kiss, Irish, only a kiss, that's all. But inside me, I know what it was. It was a little bit of excitement in this dull, boring world, where all I've got to do is play darts and get pissed and look after an ungrateful husband and an even more ungrateful daughter. Danny, washing glasses behind the bar, calls over to me. Your taxi will be here in a minute. Irish asks, can you drop me off, Katie? When I get home, the house is in darkness, and I let myself quietly into the front room where the embers of the fire are still glowing. Jerry's voice comes out the shadows, making me jump.
Don't turn the light on, Katie.
He's sitting in his usual chair, and his words sound muffled. Jerry, it wasn't like it looked. I want to tell him how I felt, how I wanted things to be, but I don't have the words. Jerry's talking quietly and deliberately, and the meaning is lagging behind his words. I'm thinking about them, digesting them slowly.
In the morning, he's saying, I want you gone.
Gone? Gone? What do you mean gone? What about Laura?
He says me and Laura will be all right.
I'm angry now and I'm drunk and I'm not talking in the dark to someone who doesn't understand what I want, what I need. I flick on the light and I can see his eyes are red and his cheeks are wet. He's been crying. And for the first time this night, I wonder, my God, what have I done? Then through the drink, through my self-justifying argument, I see me from his side, and I don't like what I see. Jerry gets up from his chair, wipes his sleeve across his face.
I'm going up to bed. Your case is in the hall.
I don't sleep. I shovel a bit of coal on the fire, wrap myself in a blanket, light a fag and sit out the night. I wait until dawn sneaks in the window, and then, not sure if I'm devastated or not, I go to Mum's. I suppose I was in some sort of shock, but I was thinking that it'd all blow over because I hadn't really done anything. Not really. Mum's kitchen light is on, and I can see her through the net curtains of the window. She's hunched over the sink, filling the kettle for her morning cuppa. She must hear the click of the garden gate because she's suddenly still, listening. Then she lifts the net and peers out. But I'm already at the door, a refugee with a suitcase on her step. Surprise is not too strong a word for Mum's reaction.
Katie?
She says. What are you doing here so early? Then her eyes drop to my case and she ushers me in before the neighbours can see. We sit in Mum's lovely warm kitchen and I drink her sweet tea and eat her hot buttered toast. And I tell her all that's happened. I tell her what's wrong with my life. I tell her why I kissed Johnny James. I tell her everything that I couldn't tell Jerry. And then I cry. I cry properly. I sob my heart out at her kitchen table in her one-bedroom house while she strokes my hair and tells me not to worry. A little later, she says, what about Laura? I'm bitter then. She's a daddy's girl. Mum just says, oh, Katie, she's yours as well. I tell her I don't want anyone to know about me leaving, not yet. But she says that Ellie will be coming round later this week.
She'll wonder what you're doing here.
Ellie's my younger sister. Ellie, who is everything I'm not. Small, slim, pretty, blonde. 6 years younger than me. She looks like a china doll, but she's anything but fragile. She'll see me here, and that superior look will drift over her face. She won't actually say these words, but it'll be plain. Messed up again, Katie. This first day, I don't set foot outside. I sit and smoke in the front room with the window open and Mum spoiling me. I phone work and pretend I've caught flu. My manager says, take a few days, Katie. I don't want the whole line going down with it. I imagine the girls in assembly clicking parts together to make a whole. There'll be talk about last night's soap and jokes and gossip about me. Did you know she's been carrying on with that Johnny James? Been going on for months, you know. Such a nice bloke, her husband. Quiet ones are the worst. Well, she was hardly quiet, caught on the job round the back of the pub, having a knee trembler. There's a round of dirty laughter. But I'm hoping that this is my imagination and that the secret, my secret, is kept by Irish, by Danny, by Jerry, by Mum, by my sister, by my daughter, and not forgetting the man himself, Christ. It's hardly a secret anymore. The second day, I go back to my house that isn't really my house and let myself in the back door. The house is empty of sound, and I tiptoe around like I'm a burglar. I don't even light up a fag. On the kitchen table is Laura's schoolwork, and her English exercise book is open. Across a half-finished essay, she has scrawled in angry scored words, I hate Mum. If I had any tears left, I think I'd cry again. I make myself a cup of tea and have to drink it black because there's no milk in the fridge, there's no bread in the cupboard, no veg in the tray. This gives me a feeling of satisfaction. Now they'll see what I did. So why do I make the beds, hoover the floor, put the dirty washing in the laundry basket? And why do I take Jerry's porn DVDs and dump them in the trash can? And why do I write in soft, gentle words under Laura's condemnation of me? I love you. This evening, me and Mum sit and watch the soaps. We drink tea and nibble on biscuits while the world carries on outside. Just me and Mum, like it used to be. Like I can remember before she married and had Ellie. Mum says, you only four, Katie. But I do remember, and now I'm 35 and I'm in this limbo of not knowing what to do.
You've got to do what's right.
It's okay for Mum to say that, but I don't know what is right anymore. So I say to her, then why did you marry Jim? Because if ever there was a mistake, that was it. You know, when we left, I never called him Dad again, even when he used to pick up Ellie on a Sunday. She would come back clutching the latest CD and talk of Big Macs and Mr. Whippy and toffee popcorn and rides in the theme park. But he never took me. Why did you marry him? Mum's gone very quiet.
Because it seemed the right thing, the only thing to do.
Then she adds, so quietly that I almost don't hear it, at the time. And after that, there's no more chat about Dad, Jim, this night. About 11 o'clock, just as I'm tucking myself into Mum's sofa bed, my phone rings. It's a number I don't know, and when I answer, I'm ready to give someone a bollocking for calling this late. But the voice says, Katie, it's me, I'm outside. And the voice belongs to Johnny James. And when I look out of the window, I can see the glow of his cigarette as he loiters with intent in the darkness at Mum's gate. Thursday night darts practice. Katie. Thursday nights is darts practice at the Bluebell, and I've half a mind not to go, but because I'm captain, I feel obliged to show. When I get there, the girls are already throwing at the board. An Irish has me a vodka and coke on the table.
I knew it would take more than that to keep you away, she says.
I suppose there are a few curious looks towards me, but I'm only today's news.
a little excitement to stir boring lives. What surprises me is that I don't really care what anyone thinks. Now, there's the six of us here, and usually we just have a couple of drinks and go home early. But tonight, my girls sit me down and keep the vodka flowing. Of course, they want to know what's going on, and I say, catching Irish's eye, bit of a row with Jerry. Need to cool off at Mum's for a couple of days. You know what it's like. They all nod in understanding, even Pegs, who can't have a clue what I mean. I say to her, stay away from men. They only bring trouble. Irish says,
get yourself a friendly rabbit, Pegs.
And laughs until she nearly chokes. But Peg's eyes have flitted into the bar, where big Dave Trinder, all of 21 years old, is hunching his shoulders in his leather jacket and trying to look cool. He's nursing a pint and casually flicks his gaze around the barroom. Only when it falls on Peg's, it lingers.
You've got an admirer, Maggie tells her.
And that word reminds me of the other night when my trouble started. Scotty Dog, scratching her boob, adds,
I wouldn't mind getting into his van on a dark night.
Pegs mumbles.
It's nothing like that.
She picks up her darts and throws at the board. Irish says to her back,
nothing like what, Pegs?
And she doesn't answer. But later, when she goes up to buy the drinks, they have a chat, her and Big Dave Trinder. I'm watching her like a mother. I mean, an older sister. And there's an easiness to their talk, as though the ice has been broken, as though they already know each other quite well. Seems like Pegs is a bit of a dark horse, and perhaps she's already been in the passenger seat of his transit van. What am I doing? I've enough problems of my own without brewing up a romance that's none of my business. I feel guilty then, because I should be worrying about Laura. I should be sorting things out with Jerry. Tomorrow, I tell myself. I'll phone then. Tomorrow seems a long time away, and meanwhile, I'll be practicing darts as normal. I'll be drinking vodka and coke as usual. I'll be going out for a fag as usual. But Johnny James won't be there as usual. I sit in the designated smoking area. That's what Danny calls it. And smoke two fags in quick succession. Then I give a V's up to that bloody camera and go into my girls. About 10:30, when Paddy starts to sing, we begin to drift off to our homes. The girls to their old ones and me to my new one. We leave Danny saying, Jesus Christ, Paddy, why'd you do that? There's still 30 minutes to go. Mum's waiting when I get back and she makes me a mug of cocoa. We sit by the gas fire and I give her the other gossip, the stuff that's not about me. We're friends, me and Mum, and it's just the two of us. No ghost of Jim issuing his orders. No spoilt sister monopolising attentions. We sit and talk, and I tell her about next Monday's league game, about Pegs, about Big Dave Trinder. Mum says that it wouldn't work because Pegs is a traveller and they live differently. She whispers it. Than us. And that reminds me of Jim and his rants on everything under the sun. Foreigners, Mrs. Thatcher, his boss, but most of all, gypsies.
That lot, he'd say. Hitler had the right idea. Stick 'em all in the gas chamber.
He even signed the petition to move them on from the station yard. He and Mum had a row about that. They've been there for ages, coming and going. Don't do no harm to anyone.
You would say that.
What do you mean? Then they'd be off like, well, like me and Jerry. Only it was much worse for Mum because Jim was quick with his fists where she was concerned. Next morning, I'm on 5 and counting. I phone Jerry early and tell him I want to meet Laura. He says,
I'll have to ask her.
Ask her? She's my daughter.
I'll have to ask her.
I'm angry then. He's being obstructive, deliberately making it bloody difficult. I conveniently forget she doesn't answer her phone to me. I'll be there when she comes home from school, Jerry, I hiss.
Look, you're the one who fucked about. You're the one who left us. You're the one who...
He
He doesn't finish because I don't let him. I hang up on him, wishing I was hanging him up by his scrawny neck. I let myself into our house, my name's still on the tenancy book, and make a cup of tea. Now there's milk in the fridge and sugar in the bowl and the larder is full. I check the living room carpet, clean. I check the beds, all made. I check the airing cupboard, all ironed. Yes, ironed. And clothes stacked neatly on the shelves. The only room that's still up for slum clearance is my daughter's. I'm downstairs again when the front door rattles open and Laura comes in.
Mum?
She says it just like she's saying hi to someone she doesn't particularly like. I wanted to see you, Laura, to explain things.
Dad said that, but there's no need. I know what you did.
What I did? Probably half the town knows what I did by now, but only I know why I did it. And while all of this is going on in my head, Laura, my 15, soon-to-be 16-year-old daughter, goes under the sink for a bowl of potatoes. Then she starts to peel them, with the knife I always use.
Laura, what are you doing? Dad's tea. He'll be home in half an hour.
She says it matter-of-factly, this younger version of me. This girl who wouldn't even lift her legs when I was vacuuming. This girl who wouldn't wash a cup, who stayed in her room night after night, streaming the same song over and over again at full volume. And then she says, I'm thinking of giving up school to look after Dad.
You can't, Laura.
I can. You can't. She looks at me coolly like she's a woman, like she's my equal.
You did. You left school at my age.
I suppose my mouth is open in amazement and I'm popping like a goldfish out of water. I want to tell her it was so different then, but she carries on.
Dad'll be back soon. I think you better go.
I've cried a lot in the last few days, but I'm fucked if I'm going to let her see me cry now. I never thought that she would be so remote, so unreachable, so cruel. My own flesh and blood throwing me out, well, ordering me to leave my own house. I start to mumble something about coming round again in a day or two, but Laura cuts me off abruptly.
Bye, Mother.
She holds the back door open and tells me goodbye. I light a fag and make sure I leave in a cloud of smoke like the Wicked Witch of the West. Or is it the East? I'm so pissed off, so misunderstood, so misjudged, and all I've got to look forward to is a flat, dull weekend and darts on Monday. A Saturday night in October at the Bluebell. Still Katie. Saturday evening, miserable and moping. I'm stuck at Mum's watching TV and criticising her favourite programmes. I'm really getting on her nerves.
For God's sake, Katie, she says.
Can't you phone one of your friends, get out from under my feet? It's almost as if I were the teenage girl again. I walk on down to the Bluebell, my home from home from home. And the Motley Crew are there. Been there all day, going by the state of them. They're crowded around a half-hearted fire, and above the mantelpiece, the mirror on the wall reflects misspent youth, red-veined middle age, and blue-nosed addiction. But they're so happy, this alcoholic family. So nice. They might be a bit unsteady on their feet. They might laugh at ridiculous situations, but they embrace me and welcome.
It's the lovely Katie, says jilted John,
who got his nickname because he was dumped twice at the altar.
The best looking girl in here, says old Bob.
I'm the only female in the pub, but I like the girl bit. At the bar, Danny's poured my drink without being asked. How's things? Not too bad, Danny. No? All right, this shit. I'm living at Mum's. My daughter won't talk to me. My money's running out fast and everyone thinks I'm a tart.
Could be worse then.
I have to laugh. Nothing seems to faze Danny. All those years behind the bar, I suppose. Lena comes in a bit later with a gaggle of lookalikes, all boobs and bums and bare flesh under mountains of hair. All giggles, lipstick, eyeshadow and strong perfume on a girl's only night out.
We're off to the club, she says. Why don't you come with us? I look at them and their colour and youth, and then I imagine me, overweight with a hairstyle 5 years out of date and a dress sense stuck in the last decade. Me go with them. I'd look like a retard on a day out. Another time, Lena.
Sure. Anyway, see you on Monday.
As quickly as they arrive, they leave. Drinks not back and quick visits to the loo over. They take their freshness and colour with them and leave me with just my envy for company. I sit at the bar, chat to Danny, while people drift in and out. Most of them I know, as I said before, it's a small town. Some speak, some nod, and some, Jerry's workmates, pretend not to see me. About 9:30, I pop out for a fag and Johnny James is sitting at the smoker's table.
I knew you'd have to come out sometime, Katie.
He says this with a laugh in his throat. He's smartly dressed tonight. He wears an open shirt with a light jacket over it, and it reminds me of how young he is, and that's another reminder of dowdy old me.
I'll come in, buy you a drink.
Johnny, I say, there's enough trouble going on without making it worse.
I expect we're being watched now. He looks to where the red button of light blinks in nosy surveillance at us.
I'm finishing my fag, as he says slowly, deliberately, if you won't let me buy you a drink here, will you come back to mine later? I want to tell him that he's too young, too tempting, too good-looking, too dangerous for faded, jaded me. I don't want him to break my heart. I say, I can't, Johnny, I can't. He stands up, moves close enough to touch, close enough for me to want to touch him. Katie, he says, the other night, it wasn't a one-off, you know. Not for me. I can't answer. I shouldn't answer. I can only shake my head as I brush past him. So what do? I go back in the pub, throw a few more voddies down my neck till I'm past caring, and then make my way to Mum's. I'm nearly there, nearly to my new home, when Johnny James glides up in his big BMW and lets the window down.
Do you want a lift, Katie?
I tell him I've only got a few yards to go, and he says for me to jump in anyway because it's no trouble and the streets aren't safe for a good-looking woman this late at night. I don't know if it's him and his smart car or me and my need of being held, or maybe all of that, but I get in, and I don't go to Mum's until the next morning. And by then, I've done everything that Jerry thought we had. So fucking there.
Monday night darts in late October. The Bluebell versus the Phoenix away from home. Irish. Gobshite says, you won't be too late tonight. His thick Belfast accent that used to chant for Ireland's 32 hasn't altered a shade in the long years I've known him, loved him. Gobshite is lounging on our bed, smoking. His wet hair is palmed back from his forehead, and he's watching me get dressed. His tongue is flicking across his lips like a snake. I'll be as late as it takes, Michael. I silently add on, gobshite. He slips off the bed while I'm still in my brown stockings and makes a grab for me. I slap his hands away. For fuck's sake, Michael, not now.
So when you come back? When you're a bit tipsy?
Depends if we've won or not. I'm saying this, but the burning's starting inside of me, and he knows this. He knows me so well. Irish, he says. Even he calls me Irish.
You'll show me when you get home.
Michael, I'll show you. I'm affected now, really affected, and I have to leave now or else I won't be able to.
Think of me, he says as I'm closing the bedroom door behind me.
He knows what'll be in my head all night. He's a bastard as gobshite. Now, in the ritual of every time I leave the house, even if it's just a visit to the shops, I kiss the tip of my finger. Then I touch the cheek of my child who laughs at me from his fading image on the hallway wall. Good night, Davy, I whisper. Sleep tight. Don't let the bedbugs bite.
but there won't be any bedbugs. Not where Davy lies. I'm the last to arrive at the Bluebell. Katie has pulled the drinks in and she looks tired, a bit detached. How's it going? She shakes her head. It's not too good, Irish. Not too good. Take it out on the darts, I say. I join Pegs, Maggie, Scotty Dog and Lena having a few practice throws before our game at the Phoenix, before Danny, our taxi. Hurry up, I've got a pub to run, herds us out to cram into his 4x4. The Phoenix is a modern pub. One big open bar, a jukebox that vibrates the glass in the windows with enough noise to drown any attempt at conversation. By the way I judge it, I think I must be getting old. And age reminds me of sleepy country pubs, the slow tick of the clock, and halves of Guinness on hot afternoons. It reminds me of wet evenings on the bus to Dublin to the darkness of the cinema. It reminds me of Michael and his visits from the north when we were young. So we're not keen on playing here in this shiny new Phoenix. Well, except for Pegs, who's no age, and Lena, who actually likes it here, and Katie, who looks like she couldn't care where she was. Maggie's tapping her foot to a rap song about stabbing a policeman or something like that, and even Scotty Dog is laughing with the barman. All right, so it's me who's not keen on playing here. Our opponents, the Phoenix Vixens, can only pull in 4 players, so that gives 2 of us a free outing. We look at Captain Katie and she says, I'll stand down. I say, and me, before anyone else can get a word in. I keep Katie company when she goes for a fag, and outside it's already dark. There's a bunch of smokers forming a circle of exiles in the doorway, drawing ravenously on their glowing cigarettes, standing in their halfway house, torn between a wanting for beer and a craving for tobacco. Katie and I sit down and I say, so are you going back then? I don't want to go back. Johnny James? Best not go there, Irish. She looks miserable. It's as though the world is settling onto her shoulders. The thing is, Irish, I'm not even sure what I want. I start, Laura, she snaps. The whole fucking world doesn't revolve around Laura. Sorry, Katie. No, I'm sorry, Irish. Sorry for this whole fucking mess. Then her mobile beeps a text message and she stares at the screen. Irish, she says, I've got to go. What about the darts? I've got to go. And she gets up and walks away, just like that. Inside, Lena's won her game and Scotty Dog is down to a double. Maggie says, where's Katie? I say, bad week, wrong week. And they all nod with the understanding of sisterhood. The match is over without the loss of a leg, and I'm glad to be heading for home. I want to be out in the air, away from the continual throb of loud music and the shouted conversation. It's still early, well before 10, and I don't join the girls for a trip back to the Bluebell. I say, yawning, I'm due an early night. I walk home in the evening of this English town, where a drizzle of soft rain is settling on the pavements, dribbling into gutters. I'm passing street pubs, crowded centre pubs, the alley pubs where the old boys click down their dominoes. It's become an almost familiar comfort, the roads, the buildings. But how I miss the green of County Meath. And how I miss that time of innocence when I first met Michael. He's strange, is Michael. He stays with his uncle on a lonely farm miles from town, but he's not a farm boy. He's tall and light on his feet. You can tell that he's not sat on his arse all day on a tractor. If me and Dad meet him on the lanes, his greeting, good day to you, is in the harsh accent of the north. Sometimes he comes to the bar of the Fountain Hotel and takes the Guinness steadily for a couple of hours. Guinness and cigarettes in equal measures. He'll sit in the corner, his back to the wall, and watch the door like he's expecting someone. The barmaid, Rosie O'Hara, reckons he's a man of mystery. And if she can't get any information out of him, no one can. She also reckons that he's too good-looking to be on his own. And if she was on the right side of 40, she'd be after having a crack at him herself. But, to be sure, nobody bothers him much except to ask for the health of his uncle. "Sure he's fine, and why wouldn't he be?" is all they'll get in answer and question. But he'll catch me with a look, with a hint of a smile, on his way out. He'll hold my eyes and then nod, "A good night to you, young lady." And I'm thinking, he's a cheeky sod, because he must only be 3 or 4 years older than me anyway. Then one night, he's waiting for me outside the hotel bar and he says, "I'll walk you home, Mary." He takes my arm. We talk, and it's not the monosyllabic young man of before. He tells me of the life in Belfast, of vibrancy, of the sights, of the clubs. He talks quickly. He makes me feel like a country bumpkin, a bog trotter. When I ask about the troubles, "Is it like in the newspapers?" He thinks for a minute. "Sometimes it's bad," he says abruptly. And I don't ask again. We stop at the corner to my house and he turns me to him, slips his arm around my waist, tells me I'm the most beautiful girl he's ever seen. Then he kisses me, long and hard. I'm telling myself that I should struggle, that I should protest, that he shouldn't think I'm easy. But the night is concealing and his body fits the length of mine. And although I hardly know him, I want more. I've been kissed before, gone further even, though that never comes out at confession. But this is something different. "Saturday," he whispers. "I'll borrow the old fella's car and take you out." Then Dad's dogs start to bark and the porch light comes on and Michael melts away. And as he melts away, the yearning starts. But Michael doesn't come for me on Saturday. His uncle says to me after Sunday church, "He had to go. Urgent job came up." He passes me an envelope. Michael has written, "Mary, I'll be back next weekend, then we'll have our day out." He signs off with a single kiss. And that's how it is with Michael. He comes and he goes. He works on his uncle's farm for a few weeks at a time. "Got to help the old fella out," he says. Then he's up to the north for a building project. But there's never a number to phone or an address to write to. "I'm always moving about, Mary," he says. So it's him who contacts me. Him who rings in the dead of the night. And me who answers in our cold, tiled hallway with the nosy moon peeping through the window. Dad calls through the thin bedroom wall to me. "Why can't he be phoning at a decent hour, Mary?" I catch Mam's muffled something about being young once. And I whisper my yeses to Michael as he tells me what he's going to do, what we're going to do when we meet up. "Just hurry back," I say to him. And I'm sure he hears the tremor in my voice. Then Dad bangs on the wall. "For Christ's sake, Mary, I've got to be up at 6. And Michael signs off with a promise. And it's that promise that's on his mouth when I meet him at the station a week later. Oh, the drug of himself. I live for the times he's back, for our love in the secret places. But sometimes there's no waiting. There can't be. Sometimes I'll meet him off the train, and in the back of Patrick O'Rourke's grubby old taxi we'll start. And that's how it is with Michael. That's how it always is with gobshite. The house is in darkness when I let myself in and I call out, Michael, are you there? There's no noise, no sound. I don't click the lights on.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.